Hello and welcome to this short video series about machine learning that we put together for you at Modulos. If you are just starting to get acquainted with machine learning, you're probably overwhelmed by the huge amount of seemingly unrelated concepts. Our idea here is to offer you a sweeping overview of some of the most important concepts and show how they fit together without going too much into details. Our hope is that once you've acquired the bigger picture, it should be much easier to dig deeper by yourself into any sub-area that you want to focus on. My name is Bojan, and the main goal of my work is to empower more people to take advantage of machine learning by making it more easy to use. Here's an outline of the topics we'd like to cover in this video series. Each topic is formulated as one particular question related to the field. We will talk about what machine learning is, what kinds of problems it can solve, how do some of its methods work, we'll talk about what's a machine learning model, how does a workflow look like for someone who practices machine learning, and what are the ways in which this workflow can be made easier for practitioners by the use of automation? In this video, we will focus on the first question. So let's jump right into it. Here we'll try to define what machine learning is, and we'll try to place it in the broader context of other fields and disciplines. Machine learning can simply be seen as a form of computer programming. To start off with defining it, let's first consider what it is not. In other words, let's try to contrast it with the classical way people were doing computer programming. In the simplest way to define it, a computer program is something that takes input data and produces output data. The idea is that input data is something we already have and we can provide to the program, and the output data is something that we would like to have but need the program to produce it for us. In this classical view, the program in itself contains all the information that is needed to perform the task we need. Furthermore, the program is entirely defined by a human programmer. However, there is a problem with this approach. The problem is that it assumes that the human is capable of defining our program. As we'll see, there are many situations where this assumption unfortunately doesn't hold. One example of such problems is handwriting recognition. Specifically, given input data consisting of an image of some handwritten text, can we recognize and return the text in a plain machine-readable format? This task is very easy for humans, but why is it so difficult for a computer? To be able to notice this difficulty, we need to zoom in a bit and take a look at how certain things are represented by a computer. In a computer, an image is represented as a grid of pixel values. And each pixel value is stored as one, or sometimes more, numbers that represent the color intensity of an image. For example, we can choose to store the intensity of the color white. In this case, pixels that are bright will be associated with larger numbers, and pixels that are dark with smaller numbers. A typical image is a grid of thousands and often even millions of these pixel values. On the other side, our desired output is text. Computers store text in an array of numbers where each specific number corresponds to a character in the text. For example, W corresponds to 119, A to 97, L to 108, and so on. So, as we can see, the challenge lies in transforming that image represented as a huge pixel grid into a small representation that encodes the written text in the image. For a single word, there is an extremely large number of inputs containing highly irregular patterns. When people first started figuring out how to construct a program that would solve this task, they came up with many approaches. One such approach might include slicing the image into segments that would represent each individual letter. Then some of those slices might be wrong, so we construct a model of various different ways to slice up the image. Then for each slice, we would try to recognize the character it represents. And then we use some dictionary of words to try to look up which word is the most likely one to be written. This approach seems to work for relatively simple cases, but it turns out to be not very robust in real-world scenarios. Problems like the one we just mentioned, ones that are easy for humans but hard for computers, gave rise to an area of computer science called artificial intelligence, or AI for short. The aim of this discipline was to give computers some cognitive abilities which come naturally to humans. For example, logical reasoning, such as drawing conclusions from facts, which are often vaguely defined. perception of visual, auditory, or some other form of stimulus, planning a sequence of actions in order to reach some goal, or controlling a robotic body by moving its parts in a coordinated way. This field started to take off way back in the 1950s, and this era, leading up to the 1990s, is what people today call the era of classical AI. We wouldn't be too much off to say that we can define this era as dominated by AI before machine learning. And the key thing that identifies it is the idea that all these cognitive abilities can indeed be explicitly defined by a human. Here we think of both writing the code of the program itself, but also of expressing our knowledge to the computer using some system of symbols, for example, some form of simple mathematical logic. This approach did seem promising and managed to show some success, although relatively limited and in somewhat narrow scenarios. Unfortunately, it ended up lacking robustness and generality for most real-world scenarios. In an effort to solve the shortcomings of the previous approach, people started looking for things that could be missing. A key idea came from an observation that humans are not born with most of their cognitive abilities. They develop them through a process we call learning. We learn by making observations about the world, and then we implicitly gain new knowledge, which we can use, for example, to make associations between objects. For example, a male face and a female face can both smile, or make some predictions about its properties. For example, if a person has gray hair, they're more likely to be older than a person with dark hair. To apply this idea to defining a computer program that has cognitive abilities, we can identify two phases. The first one is called the training or learning phase, and the second one is called the inference phase. So, this means that we should consider having two components of our program, the learning algorithm and the predictor. They usually work hand in hand, and they are defined by the programmer. However, they do not contain all the information we need to perform our task. That missing information comes from input data examples or observations. The same way a human would learn by making observations. For example, here we have a dataset with handwritten digits. If we never saw digits in our life, a dataset like this would probably still be considered a solid learning material. However, as we've described earlier, this representation is not good for a computer because it cannot reason easily about individual pixels and those irregular patterns. That's why we need a learning algorithm. It transforms the input data into a representation, which we call parameters or weights, organized in some way which can be understood by the predictor. Then the predictor can use them to take new input data and produce the desired output data. To summarize, the key thing that defines machine learning is the existence of this hidden knowledge which we encode in the form of parameters. As opposed to classical AI, we assume that this knowledge cannot be explicitly provided by a human. Instead, it is extracted from real-world data during the training stage. Here we would like to mention a special subfield of machine learning called deep learning. We mention it here simply because of its extreme popularity. Deep learning is an approach to solving problems using artificial neural networks. Neural networks have been around for decades. They are constructed from a set of simple computational units called nodes, which pass information along a network structure that is organized into layers. Put simply, a neural network is deep if it has many layers. For many years, this method gave very limited success, especially for deeper networks. Looking back, we now see the reasons for its poorer early performance. As people managed to overcome these blockers, they were able to unlock the full potential of neural networks, which we see today all around us. The main two of those blockers were lack of large amounts of data, which proved to be essential for training neural networks. This was solved in the age of internet and big data. And the second one is the lack of powerful computing hardware to run those deep networks. This was solved by discovering that GPU processors can give massive speedups when applied to neural networks. As an overview of the main concepts we mentioned, we are talking here about fields of computer science. Artificial intelligence is one of those fields. We have classical AI as a subfield of AI, which was dominant for many decades. Nowadays, we have the dominance of another subfield called machine learning. And finally, this subfield is today still dominated by deep learning, an area that is defined by the usage of deep artificial neural networks. And of course, as a small disclaimer, we should take note that this is all a rough simplification we did to make it easier to understand the relationship between the most prominent disciplines. That's all we have for this video. We really hope it was helpful in clarifying some basic concepts. Make sure to check out our next video about the kinds of problems that machine learning can be particularly good for. Finally, feel free to check out our website and learn about our very own effort to make it easier to use machine learning for your specific problem. You'll find all the links in the description.